For this video, we're going now into the female anatomy. When we're talking about the female anatomy, we will be focusing on the internal anatomy. However, we want to discuss both the internal and external very quickly to make that distinction, as there are some terms that are used casually that don't quite mean the same thing in biology. So we can split female anatomy based off of internal and external. The internal components are part of the genital tract, and they include the ovaries, the oviducts, the uterus, the cervix, and the vagina. The external genitals, also known as the vulva, include the labia major, the labia minor, the mons pubis, and the clitoris. Let's look at the genital tract. The primary sex organ of the female body are the ovaries, as these produce eggs and sex hormones. The oviducts work similar to the vas deferens we saw in the male reproductive system. The oviducts will move the gametes, in this case eggs, from the ovaries towards the uterus. It's also the normal site for fertilization. Many people may think of the uterus as where fertilization occurs. However, that's not the case. The oviducts, also known as the fallopian tubes, are the primary site for sperm and egg to come together in the process of fertilization. The uterus is where implantation will happen and is where fetal development can occur. The uterus basically will serve as a site for that developing embryo and fetus, all the way until birth. The cervix is the opening leading the uterus to the vagina. This is normally going to be very small, however, during childbirth, this will dilate or widen. And you can imagine why if you've ever seen the sides of a newborn baby. And then the vagina serves as the copulatory organ, as well as the birth canal. So when a child is born, typically speaking, they will move through the vagina and out to the outside world. The vagina is also the copulatory organ of the female, meaning it is the organ used for sexual intercourse. Let's look at a side and front view of the female anatomy. We see the ovary here, the oviduct kind of wrapping around it, the uterus, which is tilted forward, the cervix, and the vagina. The vulva and its exterior parts are also found here. Now, I had mentioned in the male anatomy video that the male reproductive system has an overlap with the urinary system, and that the female reproductive system does not have that same overlap. We can see that distinction here. Here's the vagina, and here is the urethra. Both of these structures are completely separate from each other. The bladder is separate, the urethra is separate, and they have separate openings to the exterior as well. Back here is the rectum and the anus. So if we look at the order, the urethra is all the way towards the front, the vagina is in the middle, and then the rectum and anus is in the back. You'll want to make note of this. It may seem silly, however, I've seen many students in the past mix these up or make a wrong assumption. If we look at the front view up here, we can see the ovaries a little better. We see the uterine tube, also known as the oviduct, also known as the fallopian tube. And you see that the ovaries and oviducts are paired. We have the uterus, and then the vagina, and the cervix would be right here. The external anatomy is on occasion casually talked about as a vagina. However, we want to make that distinction that the vagina is strictly the internal component that we see here, this canal-like structure. The external anatomy is called the vulva and is made up of many parts. The labia major, which are two large folds of fatty skin, the labia minor, which are the two small folds just inside of the labia major. And hiding between the labia minor are the openings to the urethra and the vagina. The mons pubis, which is fatty skin covered by pubic hair. And the clitoris. The clitoris is actually erectile tissue and is the site of intense sexual feeling. The clitoris is equivalent to the gland's penis in the male reproductive system. And this is why many females require some sort of stimulation to the clitoris to experience a heightened level of sexual satisfaction. Let's move on to the ovarian cycle and look at the ovary a little bit deeper. An ovary has many follicles, and each of these follicles are going to contain an oocyte, or an egg. However, this egg is immature. It's not ready to be released. When a female reaches puberty at about age 12 or 13, she has about 300 to 400,000 follicles. That's a lot of follicles. However, in her lifetime, she will only see about 400 of those follicles mature. The reason being is that only one of those follicles will mature each month. So if you consider the fact from puberty to menopause, how many cycles a female would have, it makes sense that she would only have a few hundred mature rather than all 300,000 to 400,000. A female will go through this process of a follicle maturing and being released from the time puberty starts until she reaches menopause, which is the end of the ovarian and uterine cycles. And this typically happens in middle age. Ovulation is a monthly process of releasing one of those eggs from the ovary when the follicle reaches maturity and ruptures open. So let's look at the process happening inside of the ovary. We have primary follicles, which again, there are many, many, many primary follicles. However, most of them will never do anything. The primary follicle contains the egg and will produce estrogen. One of these follicles will continue on, becoming a secondary follicle, producing estrogen as well as progesterone. These are our two sex hormones we'll be looking at. We develop a vesicular follicle, and then finally, we mature and are released. So the oocyte is released. This follicle that burst open is not quite done yet. The remaining follicle will turn into what we call a corpus luteum. The corpus luteum will produce progesterone as its main hormone, as well as some estrogen. As we continue through the cycle, the corpus luteum will degenerate and break back down unless pregnancy is achieved. When we look at the ovary, it's important to note that the process of meiosis when creating eggs is a little bit different from how we learned it. When we start with the primary oocyte, we have all 46 chromosomes. We go through meiosis 1. We create an egg as well as a polar body. A polar body is basically a chromosomal trash can. Instead of creating four daughter cells through meiosis, we're only going to create one. When we go through meiosis 1, this is the stage where the egg is released for fertilization to occur. If the egg is fertilized by sperm, only then will it go through meiosis 2. If sperm never reaches it, it will never go through meiosis 2. So let's say sperm does reach this egg, and we do go through meiosis 2. We've now created a zygote. However, there are still some extra chromosomes since we're going through meiosis 2, and those end up in our second polar body, our second chromosomal trash can. The ovarian cycle is a process of hormones helping regulate the formation and release of one of those eggs. It is controlled by the hypothalamus and the gonadotropin releasing hormone, the same hormone we had seen in the male reproductive system. And there are two phases to the ovarian cycle, the follicular phase and the luteal phase. Now remember, the gonadotropin-releasing hormone talked to the anterior pituitary gland, and the anterior pituitary released follicle-stimulating and luteinizing hormones. We will see these hormones in the female reproductive system as well. In the follicular phase of the ovarian cycle, follicle-stimulating hormone will promote the development of a follicle, and that follicle will secrete estrogen. Estrogen will spike about halfway through the cycle, which is around day 14 of the 28-day cycle. The estrogen will lead to a surge in luteinizing hormone, and this will help cause ovulation. So ovulation happens at around the halfway point of the ovarian cycle. After the egg is released from ovulation, we enter into the luteal phase. That follicle will now become the corpus luteum, using the luteinizing hormone as the promoter for this, and the corpus luteum will secrete progesterone. If pregnancy does not happen, the corpus luteum will regress and menstruation will begin. So now we look at an image like similar to what we saw in the male reproductive system, with the hypothalamus serving as our main control, our anterior pituitary serving as our middle management, both luteinizing and follicle stimulating hormone arriving at the ovary, promoting the follicle stage as well as the luteal stage, and estrogen and progesterone being released by the ovary, which then in turn communicate with the hypothalamus. The uterine cycle is also a 28-day cycle and falls in line with the ovarian cycle. The uterine cycle focuses on the changes happening to the uterus in response to the hormones being released by the ovary. In the first 5 days, there are very low levels of estrogen and progesterone. Because estrogen and progesterone levels are low, the uterine lining cannot be maintained and breaks down. This is what we call menstruation. So menstruation occurs during days 1 through 5. In the days coming after that, 6 through 13, we have the proliferative phase. This is where estrogen starts to increase in its levels, and that causes the endometrium, the lining of the uterus, to thicken again. On day 14, we have the halfway point, and ovulation usually occurs. From days 15 through 28, in the secretory phase, the increase in progesterone being released by the ovary causes the endometrium to get even thicker. This is to prepare for a potential embryo. If there is an embryo, then it needs a place to implant that is nourishing and safe. Having this thick inner lining provides that for the embryo. If the egg is not fertilized, though, then the corpus luteum is regressing and the endometrium starts to break down again. At the end of the cycle, we go back to the start of day 1, where estrogen and progesterone levels are low again, and we begin menstruating once more. It's important to note that when we say a 28-day cycle, we're talking about an average. So many females may experience cycles that don't quite follow 28 days, and that's okay. Let's look at how hormones are moving and what's happening both in the ovary and in the uterus throughout this 28-day cycle. As this follicle matures, it will be releasing estrogen. We then have a spike of luteinizing hormone and ovulation occurs. During this first time, menstruation happens, which tears down the uterine lining. And as we go through and release more estrogen throughout the days up to the halfway point, we see a slow buildup inside the uterus. When ovulation happens, the egg's released, our follicle becomes the corpus luteum. The corpus luteum is then going to produce progesterone as well as some estrogen. And both the progesterone and estrogen help build up this endometrial layer much, much thicker and much faster. However, if pregnancy is not achieved, then the corpus luteum will disintegrate and regress. And as it does that, the progesterone and estrogen levels will decrease as well. The low levels of female sex hormones leads to this thick layer to break down and regress. and then we go back to the start again.